Good morning to all of you from the North Cape University, and welcome to the North Cape Masterclass, a series of talks wherein you get to listen to eminent thinkers, scholars, and leaders sharing their perspectives on what's going on in the world and what it means to you as future professionals. As I never tire of repeating, the magic of a great university is its people, that it attracts finest students and finest faculty. Over the past 25 years, the North Cape University has been such a place, a preferred destination for talented students and faculty. Our graduates are well accepted all over the world by leading companies and by top universities abroad, and our 11,000 plus alumni strength is a testimony to how far and how high they have gone in life. All this for a simple reason. At NCU, we are firmly anchored into the future. Just look at all the specializations we offer in engineering, management, and law, from cybersecurity to artificial intelligence to digital marketing to virtual reality and gaming to latest movements in jurisprudence and law. We cover everything. And this intent also drives our recent collaboration with Arizona State University, the leading US university. Our partnership is the first of its kind in India in terms of its coverage, breadth, and depth, all designed to give you a degree that will be valued for the rest of your lives. Now, until now, we have heard speakers from industry, startups, and scholars from economics and public policy. Today, we have a guest who comes from a very different way of life, where you are trained to command a body of men to fight and die for the country. One which makes you an officer with the finest values of discipline, honor, bravery, service, grit, and perseverance. I'm talking about military way of life. Let me introduce General Singha. Lieutenant General Iqbal Singh Singha retired from the Indian Army as Director General, Operational Logistics and Strategic Movement, and was also the Colonel of the Rajputana Rifles. Earlier, he served on the United Nations peacekeeping missions in Ethiopia and Eritrea in UNME as the Chief Logistics Officer. He was the head of mission and force commander of United Nations peacekeeping force at Golan Heights between Syria and Israel. He has nearly four decades of experience in conflict resolution and conflict management. His mediation expertise saw successful release of 180 peacekeepers taken as prisoners. He has addressed the UN Security Council, Group of 77, and C-34 on several occasions on the prevailing security situation in the Middle East. General Singha is presently the Director, Global and Government Office Affairs at TAC Security, a leading global cybersecurity company which is working in partnership with USI of India and National Cyber Coordination Center, also with several state governments of USA and India. General teaches MPhil students at Punjab University and has been a panelist at the Military Literature Festival, Chandigarh. General has participated in several social awareness campaigns launched by Punjab government on drug abuse and precautions against COVID-19. He has MPhil degrees from Higher Command Course and the National Defense College. Today, we will chat with him to listen to his journey, his perspectives, and his insights into the opportunities that exist today. We will do this for about 30 to 35 minutes. Once you have followed what he has to say, you may write in your questions for him in Microsoft Teams chat, and then I'll ask them on your behalf. General Singha, welcome to the North Cape University.
Thank you very much, sir. It's a great honor to be with the university, and I must thank Professor Nupur Prakash and you, sir, as also my friend, philosopher, and guide, Colonel Bikram Mohanty. We have grown together in the service, and special thanks to all the young minds who are here, who have keyed in to listen to us today. Thank you for the opportunities.
You're welcome, sir. We are honored to have you with us. So let me begin by asking you about your journey, especially your early years. What motivated you to take up a career with armed forces?
So Normally, sir, a doctor's son becomes a doctor, or at least the parents want him to. And my father was a fourth generation officer in the Indian Army. But my parents tried making a doctor out of me. I was very relieved while doing pre-medical when my NDA interview came and I got through. So I left the medicine course in between, and thereafter joined the NDA. I was very enthused because, having studied in the military school, King George's Chal, which is known as Shimla Hills, our dream was to join the NDA or join the Dufferin. Those days there are very few professions. Either you became a doctor or an engineer, or if you're very bright, you became a professor. And otherwise, armed forces were chosen. So we had to select one of the few which were available. And our seniors used to come back from NDA and tell us how life is there. So we were highly motivated to join the armed forces. I guess it came very naturally.
So what difficulties did you face in your career? Can you tell us about a few life-changing moments that you would have experienced?
So military career is actually a very varied experience throughout your life. You get posted to a new place every 2 to 3 years, a new set of colleagues, a new boss. And so therefore you have to firstly adjust to the new environment, and you have to actually catch the train running because already a lot of expectations are there from you because of your career profile till then. Therefore, the challenges come because the no two postings are alike. They're totally different. You may have done a similar job, but each appointment is quite different than the others. So that was a professional challenge. And life-changing experiences are sometimes when you are taking life, like some of our students also, in a very relaxed manner. But somebody comes in your life and says that, look, you're capable of doing much more. So as a brigade major, as a major, I had a boss who became the Army Commander in Southern Army, General Shiota. And he raised our levels, not only mine, everybody below him, from one level to the other. And then we realized that we are capable of doing much more. So that was one life-changing experience. Otherwise, during Kargil, I was the commanding officer on the line of control, not exactly in Kargil, but south of Peepanjal in Bhimber Gali and Punch sectors. And every day was a challenging day in command because so much of fire was being exchanged between the two nations who were at war in Kargil. And we had casualties, and every time somebody gets injured, you feel very sad because it's not only that a soldier has got injured, you have probably been together in so many operations, and then you find that one of the comrades is indisposed. Fortunately, I lost only 3 soldiers, and that also not due to direct enemy action. It was the result of something else, but quite a few were injured, and that makes you a man, you know, out of I mean, of course, that time I was just a CO, but already a CO. But when you join as a young officer on the line of control and you're given responsibility of 22 people, you're entrusted their lives to you and your guidance. So I've seen my own experience and those under me. Overnight, you become so responsible for my boy next door to a very responsible officer who start thinking much beyond his years.
Now, we have heard that
NDA is a very difficult to get into and also a very, very difficult course. When you were at NDA, was there a moment where you felt you had made a mistake or you felt down, you wanted to, you went through a low and then bounced back? Did that happen?
Yes, sir. This life is full of ups and downs, like your heartbeat. If it becomes stagnant, then you're no more. So, yes, life was very challenging. Fortunately, as I mentioned, being from a boarding house, physicals were not a big problem. And again, you know, decision making, when we are at this stage, when all the students are listening to us, one is not very sure what you want to do in life. So we, as I mentioned, that one of our dreams was to go to NDA. So what I did was, I was a prefect in school, going to be house captain next year. But at that peak of my school career, I left the school and joined a day scholar school in Dehradun because my father was posted as an instructor in IMA. And I thought already, I mean, that's from NDA, we generally go to IMA in the army cadets. So since swimming and riding was, you know, teaching was available there, I thought I'd learn that before joining the NDA. And therefore, NDA routine was very tough, but it's bearable. After all, it's designed very scientifically. And only thing is that one has to make oneself mentally strong that this day shall also pass. So we lived one day at a time. And there were times when you felt that it's too much, but you told yourself, look, it's part of the training, it's part of the game, and you're not a quitter. The moment you tell your mind that, physical pain actually subsides and your mental strength, you know, takes over. So therefore, yes, there are moments, especially when you are being punished for no fault of yours, but just because in the group somebody did a mistake, the whole group is punished. And but those were the moments that you look back. Those were the fermenting years when actually they were trying to amalgamate people from all background into a soldier of India whose only religion is to look after its men in war and lead the country to victory.
So this attribute of not quitting, not giving up, you know, persisting, does that come from within or does that come from you look at each other and then you say we are all in the boat together, same boat, and so you derive inspiration from others?
Exactly, sir. That is where your camaraderie builds up, and you look left and you look right, and there's somebody who's much more tired than you and sweating more than you. And then you, some uncanny smile is exchanged between you. Okay, this shall also pass. It's all part of a big game that, you know, we have been converted from boys to men. And so we all took it in good stead. And exactly, this is how the team building is done. So they put you all in one pot, a melting pot, and then end result may be a very nice cake or whatever you say. I mean, so we were deriving strength out of some of the instructors that we saw. Look, tomorrow probably I want to be him standing there and on the other side of the fence. And also looking at your colleagues like so-and-so, who doesn't have a great physical training background, is still sustaining. Why can't I do it? So it comes from both, so your colleagues as well as your superiors.
Now, the general popular image of a military man is one who is used to giving orders and one who used to taking orders, one who lives in a very structured, defined, rule-bound world. And conflict and negotiations goes into the sphere of diplomacy. That's a very different sphere. Now, you combine both the worlds easily. I can see from your experience that you have been a negotiator and conflict resolution expert. Where did that come from?
So, sir, the years spent in counterinsurgency in the Indian Army, in our northern and northeastern borders, as also the ethos of our armed forces, primarily to use minimum force, to not treat a misguided countryman as an enemy. And all these things, they stand you in good stead. You, whatever you do in with good hope, with the corrective attitude in your mind and not punitive. And whereas the image is quite true that you receive orders and then you pass on the orders. But what I want to share with all these students today is that never ever stop thinking. There are orders passed to you for a particular reason, but how to carry them out, you have a lot of flexibility in that and in the best possible manner. Firstly, most of the times you will never be given an order which is illegal in the armed forces. You will only be told your aim is to move from one place to the other, protect your subunit and reach in so-and-so time and do this task. So how to do that task comes from your analyzing capability, which I think we should all continue to think. We should continue to evolve and empower ourselves at every stage. Armed forces is one such career where your basic laurels, like any other entrance exam, if you're passed, you become a doctor or an IAS officer or IPS officer, then you're not tested again in your capabilities. But in the armed forces, we have to continue going for courses of instructions every now and then. We have to, our selections are based on competence, like nomination for higher command course, few selected commanding officers who have done well, they are selected to do it. Again, at the brigade level, after commanding a brigade, you're selected to do the National Defense course based on your performance. So at every level, the sifting continues, because as you go up, you have to take higher decisions affecting many more lives, affecting you know, the national security. And courses like these, when we do, excuse me, with colleagues from civil services and also some foreign offices like National Defense College and all, you start looking at how they perform. And then you acquire that art of diplomacy and, you know, patience, of course, is a great virtue that is required. And a negotiator, you have to become because of the need of the hour. Since in Syria, and I know the civil war was going on, and we had to contend with a lot of these opposition armed groups who had come into the buffer zone. They were followed by the Syrian soldiers. They were firing at each other. So we came under crossfire. There were cases of carjacking and weapon snatching. The peacekeepers were detained. Some were taken prisoners. Now, to contend with such a situation, you had to think on your feet. So what I did was, first and foremost, because I actually, my task as a head of the mission and force commander were combined two caps. It was a political and a military task. So you had to rise up to it, because after all, your nation had selected you. Then you competed with five other nationalities to be there. And once the United Nations had selected you, then you had to live up to it. So in the field, you had to really think on your feet. And what I did was that my best of the friends amongst the diplomatic circle were, besides the P5, permanent five members, and the troop contributing countries, I also made friends with the ambassadors of Qatar and Saudi Arabia. My Arabic proficiency in the language was very, very, very minimal from NDA days. I brushed it up to exchange pleasantries. So whether any peacekeeper was up at that point in time or taken prisoner or not, I made it a point to meet these ambassadors every 3 months to renew our relationships and discuss the situation and give our viewpoints of what the UN was doing there. So, and convince them that, look, as long as we are there, it's good for both sides. Excuse me. So therefore, thereafter, these people, these countries, they had leverage over those warring groups. And every time we were lucky to get back our people intact. So I guess I learned on the move, sir. Necessity is the mother of invention. So became a negotiator by default, tackling those 10 to 15 difficult cases during that period. But again, the training of the Indian Army, and you see a crisis, then you analyze the possibilities. You're given a very scanty information. Then you make a mosaic, into mosaic of what actually would have happened. And then you say, okay, we got option 1, 2, and 3. All this comes very naturally. A little participation from the others. Normally in the crisis, nobody gives a suggestion. Nobody wants to be proved wrong later on. So finally you have to change, depending on your decision making. And you say, okay, we will follow option 3. Any doubts? No, sir. Okay, I'm going to my bunker now, and I'll come back after 1 hour. In the meantime, you carry out this option. Invariably, 9 out of 10 times, we were proved right in our action, and we were able to defuse the situation. And then we started predicting also what can happen tomorrow and prepare for it today. So that was a very, very interesting period.
So tell us about an interesting hostage situation that you successfully resolved.
So there is a little humor also in that, which one can, after the incident, think about it. We had 45 Fijians taken away from the only crossing position between Israel and Syria. And the position was there, in fact, by default, when these opposition groups, including some elements of ISIS, they attacked the Syrian company, which was in very close proximity to our position. They found that we had lovely buildings, a great cookhouse. They were hungry. They came down. They had food, water. They thought they might as well take up that position. So took this 45 Fijians as prisoners. It's a huge shock in the international community. So many people being taken. And then we started talking to them. Now, in the field, there's a lot of fog of war. Initially, I was told that there are 43 people. As we are talking, I was told, sir, there are 44 actually. I said, look, when the Indian Army is deployed anywhere in the world, even that last pin we count, if we have lost two bullets, forget bullets, khali khoka, after firing a bullet, we account for that also. You're telling me that you had only 43 people, but now the 44th has come. Doesn't matter. We'll handle it. So I started negotiating with these people. In the meantime, they're surrounding two more positions of Filipinos. Now, in the negotiations, they were trying to put me on a different tangent. They said, we'll talk about the Fijians later. First, tell these Filipinos to give their weapons and surrender. So I said, look, we are peacekeepers here. We are not here to fight. At the same time, we know how to defend ourselves. And these are the soldiers. They will not be put to shame like this. And please, we request you that let them be and let them do their job, or let them safely return to our side. While all this was happening, then I told them, look, I also want to talk about the 44 Fijians. And this is already 1 day later. This is so sorry, you please get your facts correct. They're actually 45. No one more. I kind of was with them, and I really looked like a fool. Luckily, he was not watching me. It was not a video. So I could hide my expression. But then I told my people also, look, we have to be very, very careful and know the exact facts. Anyway, this went on, sir. There's a lot of pressures. There was a window of opportunity when two of these posts of Filipinos were surrounded. they thinned out against the southern one and concentrated more on the one to the north. So I had already moved my force reserve company, half of it, to the south. And I told them in the wee hours of the morning, go and evacuate those people. So they came in the APCs. Although the opposition groups had AK-AT guns, automatics, but they were so aghast at seeing such a bold action by the UN troops that they came in the APCs, they quickly put those 32 guys in and they vanished. We could not repeat the same thing on the other post. No, that was strengthened, well surrounded. Then we eventually had to, they came out at night with under the RT cover by RT fire by the Syrian government. So these kind of situations, they keep coming up. Another one was when three peacekeepers from an observation post were picked up by the, again, in the middle of the night. All these things happen, you know, at a very difficult, a very different time. It's not during daytime because detection is easier during daytime. So I was told those three have been, and I knew in my mind that immediately on top of that, there is a post of Israelis. So I said, how could it happen without the knowledge of Israelis? So I told my Israeli counterparts, I said, I want my three people back within 1 hour. Please talk to those people and get them back. So they said, you're presuming that we are in communication with them? I said, I'm not presuming, I know it. I bluffed. And within 1 hour, that two men and one woman, three observers, they were from European countries, they were returned back. I said, you cannot be in a situation and not knowing your people right in front. So I know that you are in communication. And it worked. They knew that the force commander knows, and immediately they played up. So you have to think on your feet. You have to be diplomatic. You have to be coercive when it comes to it. Thank you.
So in situations like this, you need to know who to trust, and you need to read the people very well. Any tips we can learn from you on how to trust people and how to...
This is a very good question, sir. What I'm going to talk in the next few minutes or 1 or 2 minutes is on, not only applies to the armed forces, to any profession. First and foremost, we should have good knowledge, professional knowledge of anything that we do, sir. Even if you're sweeping a floor, we should do it well. You should know where the corners are. I had to have a good knowledge of the 40-odd opposition groups and their affiliation who are working in our close vicinity. We studied the psyche of the both the Israeli soldiers and the Syrian soldiers. My liaison capabilities had to be enhanced 3 times because there were times when I would have to go to Damascus to discuss with the government. My interlocutor there, a brigadier general from the Syrian army, come back to the field, talk, because there's some violent actions happening. Come back to the field, meet some of the opposition group leaders, and then go to Tel Aviv to meet the Israelis, all in 1 day. Takes a lot. It's not legislated that I had to do it. I could have done it over a week. But then again, the enthusiasm and the training imbibed by the Indian Army into us told me that this can't wait. So what I'm trying to say is that complete knowledge about yourself, about the area, about the people you're dealing with, including inimical forces, is required. Their psyche is required to build. Thereafter, have faith in yourself. Faith in the God that you believe in, and do the correct action and be very, very patient about it. I mean, they knew that when a lot of times they try to, tell you that the Syrian side, that our women are dying, our children are being ill-treated, you are doing nothing. we told them that we are a very small force. We are here to protect, make sure that Israel doesn't attack you, and likewise, Syria doesn't attack Israel. So let us do what we are doing, and all these excesses that are happening to you, the government is doing, they are being recorded as long as we are there. And we have also left our families behind. If you don't want us here, if you trouble us, and if you don't allow us to perform, we will go back and join our families. I'm already approved for a lieutenant general. I'll go and pick up a command of a corps. And you guys will be left to deal with fight on two fronts. One is your own government. Other is now the Israelis will find there's no UN in between. They can do anything because it will not be reported. So they did understand. And sometimes you have to get down to the intellectual level of that eighth failed guy who had picked up the gun, who's a leader of four people, and convince him. It took a lot of moral courage. And people who were around me sometimes told me I'd gone too far. Well, I said, look, may God be with us, and this shall also pass. So we're lucky it didn't go overboard, and the fire was not exchanged. But there were times when a small trigger could have ended in a bloodbath.
On reflecting your experiences, sir, picking an example from civilian life, this is the life of a project manager as well. You are given people not of your choice, and yes, you take upon something that is difficult. Now, how do you build a team? I think your experience is similar, that when you take the United Nations position of force commander, you are given people from different countries. They come from different cultures, different organizational ethos, and you have to tie them into a common objective and make them a coherent unit. How do you do that in a short order?
So, very pertinent question. First and foremost is your personal example. If you're talking to them that move around, dominate your area, and you are not getting out of your comfort zone, nobody is going to follow you. Secondly, every nationality brings a value addition. Every individual, human being for that matter, even in India, your team is something that is you inherit. You can't change, you can't select. You may be able to change one or two people. I believed in doing with what I have. But if you analyze each human being around you, each human being is blessed with few capabilities. You have to harness them. You have to ignore or overlook for some time, not totally ignore the weaknesses that person has. But somebody may be a troublemaker, but he may be very good at reading the maps or reading the future action of this thing. So you put his energies towards what he or she is capable of. And at the same time, I think if you give respect, you get respect. So it is very simple. And if you treat each human being with respect, they will respect the leader. It is very, very, sometimes you just wonder, how come both sides were happy with our performance and they kept giving me extension? Normally it is that one side is happy, the other side is not so happy because they feel you are inclined towards one side. But impartiality is one of the qualities of peacekeeping. Why peacekeeping? It should be of every individual. Your team, you should not, I don't think one should have favorites. Even in the Indian Army, I said, you want to be my favorite? There's only one way. Please work hard. Come up to my expectations. Then I'll love you. And that's the only way to do things. So we have to be a little analytic and objective in not criticizing a person, but criticizing the wrongdoing. Okay, your so-and-so action was not good. Not say that you are a useless chap. So as long as we respect human beings, we honor their capabilities that they have, harness them, at the same time sometimes overlook their idiosyncrasies, then you build a good team. And each man, each woman in the team must be given the importance that he or she deserves.
That reminded me of something I used to hear when I was living in America. In schools out there, the common advice to all children, my daughter was one of them, was always told by the teachers, don't criticize the person. Criticize his behavior, his or her behavior. Okay. Don't attack a person.
Because,
and
this was because if you do that, there's a scope for improvement. If you say you're a useless kid, that kid will just sulk and never improve. If you say this action of yours is not good, the person may improve upon it.
Right. Sir, as you look back on your military career and you rose to very high positions, what skills do you think that you had or you developed which are instrumental for putting where you are today?
I think the first and foremost is your conviction in your mind that what you're doing is right. We can't poodle fake and say, we can't be like politicians that you say something else and you do something else. If I really thought the situation, an impossible looking situation can be turned around and, you know, it's possible because as Napoleon said, impossible is in the dictionary of fools. And then you go ahead with it. Have full conviction in what you do. And evolve with the times. You may be fond of doing something which you did as a company commander of, say, sighting defenses up of a platoon and all. But once you're a div commander or a corps commander, you should not be looking at that. You should be looking at, you know, how best to use minimum resources at that level when you got 80,000 people to 1 lakh under you to have minimum casualty and still, defeat the mind of the enemy. So you have to continue to evolve and leave those things which are binding you to do lesser things. Delegation is necessary as you go up, sir. Delegation means you give responsibility remains yours. Accountability remains yours. You give responsibility to somebody to do it. If something goes wrong, you are accountable. So once you delegate something, and it only comes in some moral strength, okay, people will make mistakes. Then there's also a method of mid-course correction. Just go and oversee what a person is doing. If he or she is going totally in a wrong direction, you could carry out a correction. Okay, I think you should do this way. But still let them be. Don't interfere. Most of the time, people who stand on your head, they only make the people under them more nervous. You know, there used to be a brigadier when we were in the military operations. He'll say, give me that report immediately. He'll come and stand on your head. And I would tell him, sir, if you're standing here on me, I can't operate as a
military. We probably lost the connection. Pankaj?
Yeah, Milan.
I think General is off air, I think.
Yeah, he is frozen. There must be some network issue.
Hello. Sorry, sir. Sorry for the network problem. So, those are the attributes that I think one must develop as you grow. And as you get bigger or a higher position in life, you should also learn how to forgive people and not carry small things in your mind. Well, positive thinking is very important to get the best out of your team.
So how do you build a good team? What qualities do you look for in people who should be on your team?
Like we said, you mentioned earlier that maybe you cannot select the team always and you do with what you have. But the qualities that you look in the team is firstly that they should their professional acumen. Do they have in what the task is at hand? And otherwise, especially when you go for special missions, surgical strikes, you pick up those people who are the best in that job. You know, mine laying, defusing, excuse me, close combat battle. And so what is the task? What is your mission? That will dictate the size and capability of your team. And because surprise also is a very important factor, as you saw in the movies on various wars that we have had with our adversaries. And thereafter, the bigger challenge is to knit that team together, to make each member of the team feel that they are member of the team and not individuals. Whereas they may have some tasks to do individually, at the same time, they should know where they fit in a bigger frame. They should not, you know, endanger your mission by going, you know, independent direction. And then comes the faith, the trust that you build on each other, which is going to stand you in good stead in the final verdict.
One last question before I open it to the students. Can you give three good lessons for students to carry as they develop their professions?
So I think we, out of the, excuse me for this changing weather and traveling, I'm speaking from Jodhpur. I just joined my son here for a little bit. So the parting shots, or whatever we have discussed, is firstly, empower yourself professionally with knowledge. Knowledge is the biggest weapon in the world. And if you see these IT companies today, look around the world, out of top 10, there are 6 or 7 Indians who are heading them. It's all come out of sheer hard work and empowering themselves. They had something to prove to themselves and back to their families in India. So on the one is empowerment, learning your profession, being perfect in what you do. And secondly, retain the ability to analyze, especially in today's social media is so much active. There is information overload. You should be able to sift out and make up your mind what is right, what is wrong. Because a lot of minds are just engineered, young minds are just engineered towards a particular narrative, you know, and which may not be good for the individual growth. So, and third is select, of course, you can't select your parentage, and maybe at times you can't select a team as we discussed, but you can always select friends. In the university, there are 4,000 odd students. You are known by the company that you keep. So be very clear in mind what you want to do in life, and have good friends who encourage each other. And in the end, I would say the fourth point is retain your positivity, and don't always think that, you know, one setback will put you back in life. There is life beyond every mistake. Learn from them, stay positive.
Thank you. I see lots of students having questions. Let's take some of them. How did you, Sarthak wants to know, how did you imagine military life before you joined, and how did your perceptions change after serving?
Yeah, so like I shared with you, sir, that most of it was we were trained in the military school. Physically, we knew what to do. But, you know, I ran away from pre-medical to join the army. Abhi padhna nahi padega. I won't have to study hereafter. I'm going to be an officer. Most ill-found idea in mind. Every stage one had to go through some, as I told you, some examination, appear for a competitive examination for staff college. So, padhna bahut padha, fauj mein. to be where you are. Not that others didn't do, but we have got a pyramidal structure, so a lot of good officers are left at every stage who could have also been good. So this was one of the myths that you don't have to study once you get into army. And second was that I never thought at that time that maybe the armed forces will give you an opportunity to go abroad. Very few people used to go. But today's army, if you're doing a little above average, you get outings to the United Nations. Again, those three things that you told, I did add on the fourth one. But I think I'll add one more with your permission, sir, that one should, they should dream during daytime. And then if you aspire, then you must achieve it with hard work. Put in the effort, dream it, let your dreams come true. As a captain, because my unit had gone to the United Nations in 1960-63 to Congo, 4th Rajputana Rifle, a very outstanding unit. In Second World War, it won 2 Victoria Crosses. Now, we had 3 flags of United Nations, so I got one issued and put it in my room. So people had pinups of singers and, you know, actors and tennis players. I had just this flag and something else. So people said, why? I said, the dream is to go there. But I don't know whether in the armed forces I will be able to go or not. And sure enough, the opportunities opened up for us after Iran-Iraq war in 1989-90. I eventually got to go as a colonel and then as a general. But if you had a dream and you work towards it, chances are you will achieve it.
Siddhan wants to know, how did your parents feel when they saw 2 stars on your sleeve after finishing your NDA and IMA?
Somehow, being from the armed forces, it was a foregone conclusion that, you know, the stars are going to come. You see, you know, the stars on your father's shoulders and on your... So, to me, personally, it came as a natural result of 4 years of ragda. And type, but I found some of my dear friends who had come from the civil background totally, they were on the seventh heaven, and rightly so. And their parents were also very enthused. Now, if I relate the same thing, I went as instructor, as a captain to Officers Training Academy, Chennai. So, there were some parents who, obviously, they were more elderly. They were older than us because I was a captain, just 5-6 years older than their sons. So some of them were so grateful. And they said, you have changed our boy from a, you know, irresponsible or not so responsible college student who's flabby and this thing to a, you know, slim looking young officer. We'll always be grateful to you. And I would say, no, I am only a directing staff. We are called DSS. We have only shown him the direction. The rest of the effort is by him. And so please thank your son and not us. So it's an exhilarating experience when you, especially they show these days and they throw their hat, because it is sum total of what you've been through the training, whether it is 10 months, 1.5 years, or 4 years, that you aspired to become an officer in the Indian Armed Forces, and you have finally become. But to my friend, the response, that is a start point. Thereafter, you have to work hard to prove that you are a leader. So the tough portion is after becoming an officer.
Kriti wants to know, what kept you motivated to do your job in the army? Have you ever felt, why am I doing this job? And how did you deal with it, if you felt that way?
So, there are 2 things. One is that, like we said, the things will never be the same. There are ups and downs. Sometimes you get hauled up for the wrong thing. Sometimes you are very low because whatever you did was not, it didn't go well, with the people, and probably you didn't get it right. And when you're a young officer, then it is your buddies, one or two officers who are also passing through a similar thing. He said, this shall also pass, don't worry. Ek dusre ko, you know, we give that kind of support, that this shall also pass. Suppose you have a bad boss. In fact, I have yet to see a good boss, whom people say, because every boss is hated for whatever he does. He has an agenda to get things done, so sometimes people don't like it. But we say, okay, these 2 years, after that somebody else will come, things will be better. So don't give up. So first it was the support of your immediate senior and your junior when you were in dumps, and your men. Your men, they always, you know, you look into their eyes, they will always tell you, sir, you tried your best, never mind, we will do it next time, whatever, your team. And after marriage, I think your wife is a great support if you're lucky to find a good partner in life. That is the biggest gamble of life. So whenever chips were down, wife said, never mind, this shall also pass, otherwise we'll do something else if this doesn't work out. So you continue to live for another day. And the next day is totally different. It may be, you know, totally in your favor.
Every day is a new day.
Absolutely, sir. And sir, if you may add with your permission, every day when one gets up, whether you are religious minded or not, you should thank the Almighty to have given you another day to live and be yourself. One, gratitude should never be forgotten, whatever we get in life. Any other questions?
A couple more. Dhruv wants to know, I don't know if this is something you want to take. Can you please share the story of Baba Harbhajan Singh?
Oh, Dhruv, today we are in a social media age. I don't want to waste everybody's time. There is a video. Just Google, and in the YouTube, there's a video on Baba. But suffice to say, the Indian Army lives on faith. And Baba Harbhajan's story is there in one of the English novels by a leading author also. There's an India-Pakistan, India-China border, and he says there's any soldier who goes to sleep, Baba comes and, you know, slaps him, and you know, he makes him alert. So the story goes, there was this 17-year-old young boy in Nathula. His duty was to go and fetch water because on the post, you know, there was a shortage of water on the heights. We had to pick up the water. We used to pick up the water from the lower heights, from the springs and all. And there was water rationing at the post. It's not like going to the shower and brushing your teeth and letting the tap on for, you know, 5 to 10 minutes. We had rationed water. So when he went, he was there with a mule. Must have been one or two other people also. We never move alone in the operational areas. But he slipped his foot and then he was not seen. But they say because the life went all of a sudden, and that means at a much younger age, unnatural death, his soul remained there. And people could see him in his dreams. Sentries who were sleeping, they would feel that somebody slapped them. And so that young boy, who didn't even have beard, it was just sprouting. And we started calling him Baba Harbhajan Singh. And then he was from Punjab Regiment. So every time his contemporaries got one stripe, he was also notionally given a stripe. Then 2 stripes, then he was made a JCO. Every year the seat was booked for me. He's from Kaputla. So a seat was booked for him and his belongings. One or two people would accompany Baba Ji, abhi chutti ja rahe hain. 2 mahine ke baad unko lene jaate the. That faith continues till date. But sir, the beautiful point is when you go to Nathula, from that small hut where, which is dedicated to him, people come and put water there, you know, because he was doing that water duty. And you were supposed to take it after, say, 24 hours. You drink that water, all your ailments, you know, whatever you've been suffering from for some time, they start healing. That's a belief. There's a brigade commander who was a major with me, and he shared with me when I went there from higher command. He said, "Ike, I've tried it on myself. It works." So all this folklore or these beliefs, especially in the forward areas, they give moral strength to our soldiers to perform. More you can see in that video, because I also chanced to have a look at it.
So we are approaching the hour mark. So, I think we can close with one last question. Shaurya wants to know, what is your favorite quote?
My favorite quote, Shaurya, is aspire, together we shall aspire and achieve. Together is for the team. Together we shall aspire and achieve.
Right. So, dear students, big takeaways from what General has been telling us are not only limited for military life, but they are applicable to all walks of life. And the five lessons we heard: be professional, go deep and specialize, empower yourself professionally, retain your analytical ability so that you can parse through different situations as they will come to you. Select good friends, friends that can encourage you, empower you. Retain your positivity. There will be ups and downs, and dream and aspire. On that note, I think we can close this session. Let us thank General Iqbal Singh Singha for sharing with us this last 1 hour, which has been a series of exciting experiences and much to learn from. Thank you, General, for being with us today. And when the everything becomes normal, we hope to receive you at the university in person.
Thank you very much, sir. It'll be a great honor. It's been a great honor today to speak to everyone, but seeing them in person, interacting with young, impressionable young people who are the future of this country would be a great honor, sir. Thank you very much.
So we'll close the session with that note. Thank you all very much.